Hello, Defender Nation, and welcome back to another installment of Defender Giants. On today's episode, we have one of the most motivated senior NCOs that I've ever worked with. He is currently assigned to Headquarters A4S and is responsible for all actions concerning our PACAF defenders. He has a long list of accomplishments and accolades, one of which is being selected as one of the Air Force's 12 Outstanding Airmen of the Year. Our guest today is Senior Master Sergeant Chris Ricks. Senior Master Sergeant Ricks, thank you for taking the time to share some wisdom with our defenders out here. Go ahead and tell us a little bit about yourself.
Good morning, good afternoon, team. I am Senior Master Sergeant Chris Ricks. I am assigned to PACAF Headquarters, A4S Division for Security Forces, and I am in charge of operations for roughly 2,500 defenders out here in the Pacific, made up into about 10 squadrons. Very honored to be here today. As most of you know, working on the headquarters staff, we're not able to bring our cell phones into the office, so I'm filming this today from home. Looking forward to breaking some bread with you all. I'd like to send a shout out to my teammate, Senior Master Sergeant Mark Velasquez, for sending the invite to break some bread with you all today. Mark, I think this is a great platform, providing an opportunity for us to connect with generations of defenders across the spectrum and figuring out how to get out to some of the challenges and pass on some of the best practices that we've identified over the years. So thank you.
All right, Senior, let's get right into it. As I stated in the introduction, you are one of the most motivated senior NCOs that I've met. With that, what is some advice that you give to our defenders who are told that they are too motivated?
Right, so I may have heard this a time or two throughout my career. What I would say to them is, you know, keep up the motivation. Over time, what you'll learn to do is kind of listen and key in on nonverbals, right? Because sometimes that motivation may not be taken the right way. And a lot of times people want to understand, what are your intentions? You know, where are you really coming from? Do you really mean this motivation, this energy that you have? Or is it some type of hidden agenda, right? You hear that quite often, whether it's on a job or whether it's going through some form of PME. And so what I would say is, you know, just being honest with your team, letting them know what your intentions are, putting that passion behind it. A lot of times when people can see how passionate you are about whatever the task is or the subject is, normally they'll rally around you, right? But I think just being honest and upfront about your intentions, folks will normally rally around you. But really be mindful of people's nonverbals. It does matter if they're receiving your motivation the right way, because at the end of the day, you want your motivation to count, because motivation is a tool for leadership, right? So if we can rally the team and get them pumped up, no matter what level you're at, I mean, you could be the most junior airman or the most senior enlisted leader, but when you're motivated, that's a tool you can use to help lead the pack. So I would say definitely pay attention, make sure you make your motivation count.
That's some great advice, to be in tune with how we're being received, because in the end, it doesn't matter if someone is the most motivated and positive person. If others are receiving them as fake or having some ulterior motives, it could actually have a negative leadership result where people don't want to follow that person. Next question. What advice would you give to a hungry NCO or senior NCO that wants to do more, wants opportunities to lead, but it seems like opportunities are passed around to other personnel?
What I would say to them is dominate where you're at. Right. So we can't always control the job or the task that we've been given within inside of our unit or organization. But I would say definitely dominate where you're at. Understand what the intent is for the role that you've been given, and find ways to expand. Right. And to dominate where you're at. I would also say be mindful of, when it comes to leadership, that how well do you play when you don't have the ball in your hand? Right. So it may be an opportunity where it could be an air show. I mean, it could be anything that we do as defenders out there leading. But how well do you play that support role when somebody else has got the ball in their hand? And I would say that constitutes a lot of leadership. It constitutes a lot of great followership skills. And in return, leadership also looks at that. You know, how well is this person able to play the support role to help somebody else accomplish the greater good? So be mindful of that. Try to dominate where you're at. And then also keeping in mind that opportunities don't have to always be given, right? You can also get out there and seek opportunities around the base. Say at the job, within your workstation, you're not always able to get the ball in your hands. You can seek opportunities out there around the base and private organizations, no matter what tier you're at, enlisted or officer, to get opportunities to get out there and lead, right? To get in positions where, you know, you've got the position where you're rallying the team, you're handing out some task conditions and standards and helping folks get out there a common goal. So sometimes it's just the way that it falls. But at the end of the day, you know, seek opportunities to help support the team, support the person that is got that lead role, that opportunity. But if you can't get them at the shop, I would say get out there, seek them elsewhere around the base to lead. And then also seek some feedback, right? So go get with your supervisor and say, hey, you know, I'm hungry, right? I know there's some opportunities coming out and I'm interested, right, in getting the ball thrown my way. to help push it down the field towards that common goal. So seek feedback as well. Maybe it's something you're not seeing or something that you're missing that maybe your supervisor and your leaders in the organization can shine some light on for you.
Wow, there are a few great nuggets in what you just said. If someone else has point, this is the time to display great followership. We've all seen it where people have openly said, if I'm not leading this event, I'm not going to be a part of it. And that shouldn't be the answer. Another thing you said was if the opportunities aren't being given to you, go out there and make your own opportunities. I really love that. Next question. If you could have your own gigantic billboard with any message written on it, what would it say?
I would say we need you, right? Right now, there's a lot of unrest going on. Suicide is at an all-time high, especially amongst us as defenders. And I would just reiterate and put on that billboard that we need you and that you're valued and that you matter. I can't express that enough, and I feel it every time that I get on social media and I see that badge with the line across it, knowing that we've lost another defender or any airman for that matter. But I would really say to our defenders right now, we need you. You are valued. You matter, right? No matter where you're at in that organization, you're needed, and you're our most valued asset, right? And it's deeper than just our military. As you spend some more time hanging around our service, what you'll learn is that the relationships you make over the years, and especially now with social media, being to keep up with people, whether you decide to stay in the military, you decide to separate at some point, the friendships and the bonds that we make, the times that we share, whether it was a deployment or a TDY, we need you. You matter. And we want to see you do well. We want to see you excel, whether it's with this battle cloth on or when you transition out to the civilian sector or you head back home to your folks. Where you came from, you want to make sure that you're in a good status, you're healthy mentally and physically, but you also feel that you're valued and you matter. So I would definitely put that out there on that billboard just to encourage the folks that, it's always a way that we can get you the help that you need. And we understand the times get tough, they get challenging. Sometimes we can feel isolated, but there's resources out there, supervisors and leaders that care. And I would just let folks know that how much we need them and how much they matter. And then the effect it has every time we lose somebody, right? Deeper than being a defender, deeper than being an airman. Every time we lose somebody, it feels like we lose a piece of ourselves. And we can't undo that. So I would just, that's what I would put on that billboard. I would try to get more billboards put up around the world with all the contact information and resources available. But just to let folks know how much we need them and how valued they are. And it goes past this battle cloth that we wear at some point, whether they retire or they do their time and they decide that they're going to get out. We want to make sure they're okay and they can go on and continue to succeed and excel in whatever capacity that is.
We need you. What a powerful, simple statement. You're valued. You mattered. You're important. If we get that message out and actually live by that statement, who knows what kind of impact we can have within our organizations. Next question. What is one of the best investments that you have made?
What I would say to that is building meaningful relationships with a purpose, right? So at the job or getting out in the community, getting involved, but establishing relationships and rapport with people that we can carry even past the time that we serve in the military. But I would say on the job, it definitely helps us advance the ball and get things done. And I would say for our senior enlisted leaders within the organization, senior NCOs, this is where we make our money at. This is our bread and butter, is getting out there over to the CE shop or the comm squadron or FSS and making those relationships with the purpose, right? And it's not always what they can do for us, but also helping them understand what role we play, where we operate at, what we're responsible for. And so when it comes time for us to take care of our defenders, whether it's on a personal matter or to get the job done, get the mission done, we got those relationships that we can reach out and we can use to make things happen. When we're inside of a staff meeting or a key leader meeting, and we hear our commander say that there's an intent that they want to accomplish, he or she. From there, we know who to call. As we're sitting there, we know who to go pick the phone up as soon as we get out of that meeting and call over the CE because we got some problems with one of the gates, right? And there's been a 332, somebody said they submitted some time ago, but we got a teammate over there we can reach out to figure out that process and how can we get things moving along. Same thing, trying to get something funded, trying to get out to some manpower. You hear the chief down there talking and trying to make sure we can capitalize on some of those unfunded manpower requirements. And we got a teammate that work over in FSS in that manpower shop that we can make the phone call and go over there and talk to figure out how can we help advance the ball. So I would say one of the most meaningful things would be definitely establishing those relationships around the base, You may be taking a step further. They're always a professional relationship, but you may be establishing some good friendships as well. But I think as senior NCOs, even for our NCOs and our junior enlisted members, our airmen, you should make it a point as well to get out there and start understanding what's going on to your left and your right flank with the other squadrons, right? So you understand that, man, you know, there's some issues going on in the dorm, and, you know, for some reason, CE's taking a long time, but hey, you got some teammates over there, and you understand how they prioritize work. And it's not that they don't want to get there, but they may be short staffed right now, and you can help the rest of the team understand what goes on within that function. So that's the thing that I would add, is definitely get out there and make purposeful relationships around the base.
Great response in regards to networking. We never know when we're going to need help from people in these organizations. When we're out there patrolling and community policing, the person that we're out there interacting with might be the person we need to call later to help fix a pay issue for our troop, or is TMO and can help with a household goods issue. Next question. In the last 5 years, what new belief or advice has improved your life?
I would say one of my local mentors, Chief Kohler, he was at one of our meetings, and he shared some things that had helped him over the years. And what he stated was, rhythm versus balance, right? So throughout our lives, we hear a lot that we need to try to find balance between duty and between the home front, and finding times for ourselves, that we need to be able to find a balance. But sometimes you can take balance as being, you know, 50-50, right? And so when he talked about balance versus rhythm, rhythm is a good thing, right? If you can find out that, hey, at the job this week, or on this task that I'm working on, you know, I only need to give about 65% because the rest of the team has got the rest. They've got the other 35%. Or hey, at home, right? I've been out TDY quite a bit, and I've got home, and my significant other needs me to pick up the stick and now maybe give 85% so they can get 50, you know, take some time to kind of recuperate themselves. So I would say rhythm versus balance. You may not always be able to find balance in your life between the job and between your personal life, but sometimes you can find a good rhythm, right? And figuring out that, hey, at the job, you know, I need to be 100% in this week because we got a busy week. Or, hey, this, you know, at home, I need to make sure I'm putting forth a little more effort with my children or with my pets, you name it. So I think finding that rhythm versus balance is some of the great advice that I've picked up and beliefs that I picked up here recently, and it definitely helped me out tremendously. Over the last year, I spent a lot of time out on the road, TDY, so my family having to adjust and me understanding when I come home, being able to slide back into the dad role and the husband role, and being able to give my wife time where pushing her to get out the house and go out, spend some time to herself and be able to, you know, clear her mind and relax and everything like that, really has helped things out a lot. So rhythm versus balance.
I love that. We've heard about work-life balance, but that in itself doesn't exactly tell us how to execute in an ever-changing environment. I like this advice because it breaks down that sometimes work will require more out of us and we have to rely on our spouses and families at home to assist. But when we do have that opportunity, we can then pay ourselves back with the time and invest back into our families who have been carrying the load for us. We don't want to be killing it at work, winning awards, getting highlighted by leadership, but then at home our marriages and our family life is falling apart. It's tragic and it happens way too often. I like the addition of rhythm because it allows for us to surge for mission needs when necessary. And then when we're able to, we could spend more time with our families and invest for that lost time. Next question. What advice would you give to a cadet or tech school student about to enter the operational Air Force?
I would say definitely be a sponge, not a brick, right? Soak up everything. And what I mean by the sponge, not a brick is, you know, as a sponge moving through your career, you've never arrived to where you need to stop learning. And that's for anybody, let alone somebody who's just entering. So always be open to learning and picking up on new things and gaining perspective about the job, about the career field, about the bigger Air Force, about the United States military, DOD, you name it. So I would say be a sponge, not a brick. Also, when people see that you're open to learning and picking up on new things, they'll be more open to share and provide you with information. If you in a brick capacity, folks feel like when they talk to you, always tell them, I got it. Oh yeah, I know that. I already knew that. Eventually, folks will shut down on you. They'll stop communicating with you. And it may be something that you need to know that's going to help you grow. So I would say definitely as you come in, try to soak up as much and everything that you can. You're not just started living, right? So you learn how to pick up on what makes sense and what doesn't. It's not illegal, immoral, unethical, right? It may be something you can put into your rucksack. But I would say definitely find ways to continue learning. Even me as a senior master sergeant, I could swing by a unit and there's an airman going over searching and handcuffing. I'm going to listen like it's my first time hearing it, because it may be something that a new way of getting after it, a new way of doing it that I haven't seen before. But I'm going to be eyebrows up, very attentive and paying attention as though it's my first time hearing it. And I would also tell them that you can lead from anywhere. You don't need a rank or a title to be a leader. So coming in, although you're new into the operational Air Force, you're not new to life. And so you may come in and have a perspective on something that may make us be more effective. We may be able to get something done a little faster or more effective. So I would say speak up, but definitely be all ears to learn from every direction. You may come in as a second lieutenant. You may have an airman out there who's been on the job a few months longer that can help you understand why we do things a certain way. So sponge versus a brick, that's not derogatory. That's just talking about the mindset, the mind capacity of understanding that you want to be open to learning and not feel like you got things figured out.
What I took out of that is never stop learning and stay humble. It's great to be confident, but always be open to what we can learn from anyone of any rank. Next question, when you feel overwhelmed or lose focus, what is one thing you do to get back on track?
I would say for me, I focus on my fitness, get out there, get a little cardio in. But when I say fitness, not just in a physical capacity, also in a mental capacity. So I get out, of course, on the physical side, I get out there, I get my run in, I get my cardio going. Now, with the COVID going on, we do have an opportunity to work around some safe measures of being able to get back in the gym. So getting in there, getting some good strength training in, to help blow off some steam, maybe some stress, to allow me to refocus. But then also picking up a good book, doing some reading. I'm also in school now too, so getting some homework knocked out, just to take my mind off of things. But then being able to circle back around to what the task was, get myself back refocused on what the intent was for the task or the job that I was doing, and then being able to get back after it. But I would say for me, anytime I lose focus, I normally get out there and focus on my fitness from the physical and mental capacity, and then just kind of push myself a little bit to clear my mind and then get back to it and figure out where was I at, what did I leave off at, and what was the original task condition standard that I was provided to get after this task so I can refocus and get it done.
That's some great advice on regaining your focus and maintaining resiliency. That is something we must all ensure that we're making a number one priority for our lives and our well-being. Now the floor is yours for any closing comments.
A couple things I'd like to share with you that kind of carried me over my career. And one is stare versus glance, right? So this is no matter where you're at in your career, stare versus glance. And what I mean by that is, you know, if you're a senior airman right now and you're out there on a flight, you may be helping out with training for phase two so folks can get certified for a duty position. You may be a tech sergeant that's an assistant flight chief right now, or flight chief. I mean, whatever capacity you're operating in, stare versus glance. And what I mean by that is sometimes we can do more glancing than staring. And so what staring is the person right there in front of you. Sometimes, as a master sergeant, you're thinking about being a chief. You know, hey, if I was the chief, here goes some things that I would do. Hey, the chief's out doing this and that. Maybe I should be doing the same thing. When really you should be, you know, staring at that ops superintendent, right? If you're a master sergeant and you're on flight right now as a flight chief, you should be staring at the senior to figure out what they're doing to be effective as an operations superintendent, because that's your next stop, right? But sometimes we can put a lot of emphasis on looking at what we can see as, hey, the chief, that's the top enlisted, that's where I want to be at. We should be glancing at the chief, staring at that senior, at the senior master sergeant day to day, what time they getting in, what tasks are they knocking out? When we're in the flight chief meeting, what information are they passing on? You know, how often do I see them? What are some of the things they're doing to help grow us as flight chiefs? So you're staring at that ops superintendent, and then you're glancing at the chief. Hey, when we're in the staff meeting, what are the things that the chief is touching on? All right, they're talking about manpower. You know, they're talking about some of the other personnel programs and things like that. So you're kind of glancing at what the chief's doing. If that's a goal of yours, become a chief one day. Same thing, if you're that senior airman and you're training, and you're like, hey, if I was that flight chief, when really you should be staring at that staff sergeant, that supervisor. What are some of the things that the staff sergeant is doing as an effective supervisor? How often are they communicating with their folks, providing ACAs and feedbacks and pushing their folks along to be successful? Because that's your next stop. And then you may be glancing at that flight chief. Hey, one day when I'm a flight chief, here's some of the things my flight chief did to make sure we were effective, right? Every time we had some base level inspection, or when you look at our QC pass rate, or excellent, EWQ, you name it, we were pretty successful as a flight. So I'm glancing at some of those things, but I'm staring at that staff sergeant and the things that the staff sergeant do day to day to make sure that their airmen are effective. So stare versus glance, that's something that was passed on to me early on. Sometimes we can look at the stars and there's nothing wrong with that, but we got to make sure we're staring at the personnel that's in that position that we're going to be at next to make sure we're effective along the way. I would also say seek deliberate and actionable mentorship. And what I mean by that is anybody can talk, right? You can get around somebody that can read a leadership magazine, or they've been through some PME and they're motivated, re-blued, as some would say. But I would say, you know, ask the right questions on things that you can physically get out there and do to be more effective at what your goal is. If you're talking to a mentor about career advancement or about promotion, you name it, ask for actionable mentorship, like deliberate things that you can physically go out there and do and to make sure that you're moving along the right course. You just don't want to sit around and listen to somebody ramble about back in the day or certain things like that. And those are cool, right? I love some good history, especially being a defender. But when you're seeking mentorship, make sure you're asking the right question, the things that you can take back and go do to make yourself more effective. And then you find another mentor that's going to give you some more actionable items that you can physically get out there and go do. And that's how you start to build. And also, you start to build up that rucksack of things that you can pay forward. Because as you begin to advance, whether it's an award or whether it's getting to a certain level as far as promotion, now you got something in your rucksack that you can turn around and pass on to the next generation because you actually had actionable mentorship things that you were able to get out there and do versus sitting around for a bunch of conversations. So those are just two things I like to leave you with, stare versus glance, and then seeking out actionable mentorship, things that you can physically do to help you along the way to achieve your goals. I like to also say as in closing, hey, Mark, again, brother, I appreciate you for doing this. I think this is an awesome and amazing platform to keep generations of defenders connected. But also, as big as we are as an enterprise, largest enlisted career field, this is an opportunity for us to see some of the things that's working across the spectrum to help us be more effective in what we do. So, Mark, I appreciate you for doing this, brother. And to the defenders out there, I'm always available. Christopher.Ricks@us.af.mil. You can hit me up on the net, social media, shoot me a line if I can help you out with mentorship or helping you in some way in your career.
Hey, Chris, it was a pleasure to have you on. Thank you for all the phenomenal advice. I've always taken a lot away from our discussions that we've had. I wish you well and congratulations again on the 12 OAY selection, which was well-deserved. And to all the defenders out there, thank you for all that you do.